Good afternoon. Welcome to Midcap Radar. I'm Sonal Bhutra. With me is Vivek Iyer. Well, the Monday had started well for the bulls. So we are near the 22,300 mark. We've come off from those levels, but nothing to complain.
Absolutely nothing to complain about. Midcap, small cap index bouncing back after the spate of losing streak that we saw in the week gone by. But first up, let's take a look at the headlines before we start the show. Stocks open strong with Nifty near 22,300 level. PSU banks, Realty and Pharma are the big gainers, even as IT and utilities lag. Midcaps outperform.
GSPL slides in trade. It has recovered from the lows, though, after PNGRB cuts tariffs for the company's key HP pipeline network. PNGRB tells CNBC TV 18 that this is only an adjustment in tariffs and not a cut, but the EPS cut is estimated between 30% to 40%.
Volta surges in trade after UBS upgrades the stock to a buy rating. Target raised to 1,800 rupees a share from 885 rupees earlier. Say they believe that Volta will surprise on market share in the room AC segment.
IREDA gains after reporting its quarter four numbers. Company's assets under management surge 18% sequentially, while net interest margin up nearly 100 basis points on a YOY basis.
Welspun Corp surges in trade after bagging multiple line pipe orders worth over 870 crore rupees. Stock up nearly 5%.
All right, those are top headlines. But for the markets, we are up in trade today, around 133 points right now. But as I indicated, we have come off from the highs today. Mid-caps are doing well, in fact, outperforming the benchmarks today, 412 points higher. The Bank Nifty 2 is up 0.5%. And across most of the sectoral indices, or I would rather say all the sectoral indices, they are in the green today. PSU Banking Index surging the most, followed by Nifty Pharma, Nifty Realty. And as Vivek was pointing out earlier, the small cap index has also made a comeback. So that one, Vivek, is up 1.2%.
That's right. So, very interestingly, if you pull the mid-cap index data or the chart for the last week and a half, it's actually bounced back after five straight sessions of losses. And the small cap index, on the other hand, has managed to come into the gaining streak after two straight sessions of losses. So, clear bounce back you're seeing as far as the broader end of the markets are concerned. But we'll go to individual stocks. We have Horma standing by. This is our special segment, Mid-Cap Movers, where Horma will take us through the mid-caps that are buzzing around in the session.
As choppy as the market has been over the last few days, it's some bit of relief to see some bit of stability over if you look at the intraday charts. There you can see the mid-cap index opened higher, and since then it's been steady on that opening tick as well. You take a look at the top gainers on the mid-cap index and they'll come up on your screen. It's starting off with ITI. That stock is up 12% at the highest point of the day. Some sharp spikes seen over the last 30-35 minutes in that stock. Exide continues to go from strength to strength after 2 days of losses, though back 5% higher there. KC International, Aditya Birla Fashion and Hindustan Copper also doing very well. Hindustan Copper is out of the F&O ban in today's trading session. PSU Banks, as Sonal highlighted, the top sectoral gainer in today's trading session. The index is well up over 2% and led by stocks like Union Bank, Canara Bank, Bank of India and Punjab and Sindh Bank as well. Some earnings reactions, and they are on the extremes. Good earnings have done well. Sterling and Wilson, after some strong management commentary, is now up 10%. IREDA at one point was up 11%, has slightly cooled off, but is still up 7%. Persistent Systems continues to extend losses, now down 9%. It's the biggest single-day drop since March of 2018 for Persistent Systems. And Jio Financial Services also trading with gains of 3%. Summers are rising, temperatures are rising, and so are the returns in the AC and cooler manufacturers. Voltas, after that strong upgrade from UBS, is up 6.5%, as is Whirlpool, 5.5% there. And Blue Star also trading with gains of 2%. Some stocks that are doing well on the back of volumes, and you'll find Triveni Engineering there, 10% higher for Triveni Engineering. Bombay Burma off the highs of the day, but still 4.5% higher, as is UTI AMC, all of them gaining with very strong volumes. And lastly, the underperformers of the day, and Spark features in that list, down for the seventh straight day, and it is in a lower circuit as well. So not good going there for Spark, and as we highlighted, Persistent Systems as well among the losers of the day. Back to you.
Okay, all right. Thank you, Armas, for joining us as always. So those are some big movers in the broader markets. We'll keep, of course, getting you more updates on these. But it's time to welcome Ashish Galloway, Strategy Advisors, for a technical check on the market. Ashish, good afternoon. Thank you so much for joining us. Do you think we will continue the momentum that we have been seeing on the Nifty and the broader markets, or there could be some consolidation?
Hi, afternoon to you and all the viewers. If you look at Nifty, price had a gap of opening around 22,330. From there, we managed to form a low of around 22,198. And we are just moving in that range in the entire day. There is no momentum or no direction as of now. So I think over here, we need to break decisively about 22,330 levels, which is going to result into a further pullback towards 22,500. So as of now, it's best to wait on the sidelines unless we see 22,330 taken out, or on the downside, the support of around 22,150 has to be broken. So it's a range-bound market trying to find direction. And after a huge volatility we saw in last week, this, I think, over next 1 or 2 days, we can consolidate in a broad range.
Ashish, thanks for that. What are the individual stocks that you're looking at right now?
From the individual stocks perspective, I think Sobha is showing a very strong move on upside. Sobha Limited, long positions can be created here. It formed a classic consolidation pattern and about to give a breakout from the neckline. So long positions in Sobha can be created for the target of 1760, maintaining a stop loss of 1585. And the next stock on the buy side is going to be Gujarat State Fertilizers. We can clearly see the stock was consolidating over past 3 to 4 days. Today it has given a very strong breakout on the upside, managed to bounce back from that 20 days average also. Volumes are picking up with the bullish candle formation. So GSFC, one can create long positions, maintain a stop loss of 227, aiming for the target of 253.
Okay, all right. Thank you so much, Ashish, for joining us. So those are some stocks on our radar, and that's a technical check on the markets as well. It's time to slip into a break. When we come back, we'll be joined by the management of Dhanuka Agritech to discuss the company's new product launches and the overall business outlook in detail. Stay tuned for that.
Back to Midcap Radar. Well, the company in focus today is Dhanuka Agritech. The company recently launched two new products, Lanivo and MyCore Super. Lanivo marks a strategic collaboration with Japan's Nissan Chemical Corporation. We have Mahendra Kumar Dhanuka, the Vice Chairman and the Managing Director of the company, joining us now to discuss further. Good afternoon, sir. Thank you so much for joining us here at CNBC TV18. First up, talk to us about both of these products. What is the market that you're targeting? What is the market size of this product? And how do you expect these products to add to your top line?
You see, as you rightly said, Lanivo has been launched in collaboration with Nissan Chemical Japan. It is a patented molecule of Nissan. And we got the 9-3 registration for this molecule on 10th of April. So initially, we have launched at Tirupati, Bangalore, and Nasik. And we are going to launch at Indore, Ahmedabad, and Baroda. Apart from this, this is a molecule versatile, which can be used on chilies, brinjal, and tomato on three crops. First time a product has been registered initially to be used on three crops. And it can control various kind of pests, including jessets, aphids, whitefly, fruit borer, and fruit. So that way, it's a versatile product. And we do hope that in the very first year, we will be able to take the volume to around 3% of the total sales from this Lanivo. Apart from this, we have launched another molecule, MyCore Super. This is an in-house product developed by the R&D team of Dhanuka. It's a biofertilizer and can be used in all multiple crops. It can increase the yield by 15 to 20% of the farmer. Once the demonstrations are being shown to the farmers, I hope that in times to come, this product will also contribute significantly in top line and bottom line of the company.
Mr. Dhanuka, thank you for those details. Just some more understanding of these two products. So Lanivo, which is in collaboration with Nissan Chemicals, you said it is a patented product and you've got registration approval under 9-3. Does this mean more costs in terms of registration or in terms of approval under that section? And what does it mean in terms of EBITDA margins, both of these products? You did say significant revenue. Will it be similar to what Lanivo will be adding to your revenues?
No, MyCore Super will not be that, because Lanivo is a costly molecule because it's a new technology developed by Nissan. So these molecules are used in very low dosages. So the cost of the product is higher, but Mycore Super is a low cost product as it is just thrown away in the field like the fertilizer. So Mycore Super will contribute maximum to the extent of 1% in the top line of the company. Definitely the EBITDA margins are much higher in both the molecules because there will be no competition. These will be the exclusive molecule with Dhanuka. So we do hope that these molecules will help in improving the EBITDA margin of the company.
Mr. Dhanuka, you know, earlier you had indicated that you would actually be going ahead and launching around 2 to 3 new products every quarter. You've done that in the first quarter of FY25, in the first month of the first quarter of FY25. So, you know, what is the outlook or what is the pipeline going forward? Any more launches expected in the next couple of months? And also, you know, for FY25, do you stand by the guidance that you had given in terms of the volumes? Q4, we believe you may not be able to talk specific numbers, but you had given a guidance for FY25. Can you reiterate that for our viewers?
I have mentioned two to three molecules in 1 year, not in 1 quarter. Total, including 9-4, we hope that 5 to 6 molecules we will be able to launch in 1 year. So 2 more molecules are in pipeline, and we do hope one is a miticide and another is a rice herbicide. So that we are just awaiting the registration from the Central Insecticide Board Faridabad. And once we get the registration, we hope that in next RC, it will be cleared and we will be launching the same 2 molecules very soon. So they will also contribute in the new product line of the company. And what was your next question?
FY25, double-digit volume growth, your guidance, you maintain that?
Yeah, because you see, it's a La Nino year. The last year was El Nino year, and La Nina means IMD has forecasted 106% rainfall. So if rainfall is good, agriculture is going to be good, and definitely the agri-input companies will perform much, much better. Dhanuka is confident of achieving both volume and value-wise double-digit growth in FY24-25.
Okay, all right. So that's good for everyone, actually, normal rain levels in the country. I wanted to understand the general business outlook. How has demand been? We have been talking about this pressure in the agrochemical space. Has this come off a little? Is there still pricing pressure?
No, now the season is on the verge of starting. So the prices are either stagnant or they are increasing in some of the molecules. Product to product prices differ. So most of the products are now stagnant, but in few molecules, price has increased. So I don't foresee that reduction will happen in near future because season is just going to start. The farmers and the dealers are waiting for the rainfall to come. In June 1st week, it will start the monsoon, and real season will start once the monsoon comes. So that's why the second quarter is the biggest quarter in the sales for the agri-input companies. So July to September will be the highest sale quarter. But definitely, we hope that in the first quarter also, company will perform better than last year.
Okay. So one thing we want to understand is, you know, in Q3, there was some worries or a drag on OPEX from the Dahej plant ramp-up that you had seen. Along with that, you know, when we're also talking about the technical plant, you know, you had also gone ahead and downward revised, you know, what was your expectations from there? So Q4, FY25, can you give us a sense of how both of these have panned out?
You see, as you were just talking, reduction in the prices. So that happened mainly in technical grade pesticides. And the overall export demand was very low. So the technical sales was less, and still Dhanuka has to get the registration for exports in various countries. We have applied and we hope that very soon we will be getting the registration. Once we get the export registration, then the real demand for the molecule will start. In domestic market, only very limited volume was there. But this year, since we will be present from the beginning of the season. So we hope that we will do much better in the Dahej plant also this year.
Okay. So are you on track to achieve that 100 crore mark in terms of sales from Dahej in FY25 then, since you're talking about getting registrations on time? And what is the current capacity utilization there?
So presently, capacity utilization is very less, as I told you. So we are not confident of achieving 100 crores from Dahej in this year until and unless we get the export registration. If we get the export registration, then the possibility will be there. But since the export registration also takes time in most of the countries, like in India, it takes 3 to 4 years time. So in various countries also, it takes time. So domestic market, we hope to do only 50 crores volume this year.
Okay, so domestic market, you're expecting volumes worth 50 crore. Export market, you're still waiting for you to get approved so that you can go ahead and export. Any initial conversations you've had, you know, with export players who are interested in these products?
Yeah, yeah. Around 4,500 metric tons of bifenthrin technical is being exported from India. So there is huge opportunity for export from India for bifenthrin technical. The only problem is there that we don't have the export registration, our registration in those countries. Once we get the registration, definitely we will be able to start our operations in export segment.
Okay, all right, Mr. Dhanuka, we will come back to you when there's that registration approval and quarter four numbers as well. By the way, the stock has surged to the day's high right now. That there won't be any pricing pressure for now in agrochemicals is definitely a relief, not only for Dhanuka, but the entire sector. And they have spoken about the new product launches, which could come in at higher margins. And they maintain their double-digit growth targets for FY25, despite what we've seen in FY24. So that's the reason the stock is up 1.7% as we speak right now. Let's slip into a break. When we come back, we'll talk about more on markets and stock-specific action on the other side. So stay tuned for that. Welcome back. You're still tuned into Midcap Radar. A lot of earnings which are trickling in, so let's focus on them. Sterling and Wilson Renewable Energy. The stock is up over 3% on the back of its quarter four numbers. It has reported a profit after 3 years. This is our special segment. Actually, it's up around 10%. My mistake there. But this is our segment, Midcap Spotlight. Vivek, what did the numbers look like?
Well, you weren't wrong when you said 3% because, you know, the stock opened up 3%. It fell. It was in the red territory. You know, it was down 3%. After that, you know, there was the conference call where the commentary was quite strong. And on the back of that, you know, let's do a deep dive analysis as to what exactly has transpired in Q4 in FY24 and what is the management outlook for FY25. First up, FY24, when you look at the numbers, you know, it's a clear turnaround from the company. The company in Q4 has delivered a profitability on the bottom line. This is for the first time after 3 years. Secondly, you know, what's actually happened is that execution has come back. You know, it is a sensible thing given the fact that there has been significant halving as far as the input costs are concerned, and thereby execution has gone up quite tremendously. Let's have a look at the numbers quickly. Revenues on a year-on-year basis is up almost 13 times. EBITDA is at 29.4 crore versus an operational loss last time around. And when you're talking about margins, 2.5% in Q4. Profitability this time around at 1.4 crores. What is the main reason for the profitability? Like we mentioned, number one, improved execution as far as the domestic EPC business is concerned. And secondly, you know, in December, the company did a 1,500 crore QIP, which aided their debt reduction plan. Under the back of that, finance costs have gone down sharply in FY24, thereby aiding a bottom line profitability number. Now, let's, you know, quickly look at, you know, what the company say in the conference call and what's actually excited the stock. Number one, two key triggers that the market has been waiting for. Market slightly disappointed in terms of the order book. You know, the unexecuted order book is slightly over 8,000 crore. Market was anticipating two key orders. Number one is from Nigeria, and number two is from Reliance Industries. Both of these orders have not yet fructified, but the company in the conference call says they are still in negotiation, and they're hopeful that in early FY25, these orders should come in. So that is something that the market is taking quite a bit of encouragement from. Secondly, you know, what they're saying is that the domestic ordering activity is quite robust. They are L1 in quite a few orders, and they're saying that along with the order inflow they're getting, they're also getting a 3-year O&M contract, which again is positive. All of this, you know, aiding the stock up move, up almost 10% in the session today.
Okay, all right. And as you said, it's a profit after a long time, and the conference call commentary as well, quite positive. The other stock on our radar is Vodafone Idea, as its 18,000 crore rupee FPO ends today. Reema is joining us now with the subscription number there and a lot more. Reema.
Thanks so much for that. So Vodafone Idea has been completely subscribed before day three comes to an end. As of 1:30 p.m., the total subscription stands at 1.3 times, with QIB and the HNI portion being subscribed by more than 2 times, while the retail portion is inching up slowly. So around 12 o'clock, the retail portion was subscribed by close to about 0.4 times, and now it's come to nearly 0.5 times, 1.5 hours later. Now, quick word on the stock price. The stock continues to remain under pressure. In the month of April, it's seen a fall of close to about 6% from its 52-week high of 18 rupees that it hit in January of 2024. We've seen the stock correct. That said, the FPO price, the price at which the FPO participants will get allotted, is between 10 and 11 rupees. And this is less than what the promoters had put in money recently. Promoters at Aditya Birla Group infused money closer to 15 rupees. This FPO being successful is very important for the company, and it's been successful because it's growth capital. The company plans to augment its 4G capacity coverage, begin its 5G rollout, and with that, their hope is that the subscriber share loss will get arrested. So that's going to be very, very crucial, and another important aspect, because, you know, right now it's not just about Vodafone Idea surviving. They've got enough capital for the next 2 to 3 years, but for the long-term strength of Vodafone Idea emerging as a competitive third player, a stronger player, we also need tariff hikes, and here street expectations are pinned on post-elections. Back to you.
Well, thank you so much. All eyes, you know, on tariff hikes post-elections. But what we need to watch out for next is MCX. MCX is the other stock that's doing quite well in the session today. FPIs under specific categories are now permitted to participate in crude and natural gas-based derivatives. Vamakshi joins in with all the details.
Well, absolutely. MCX is a high flyer in trade today, and that is because there was a circular that came from MCX, and the circular stated that FPIs under the categories of individuals, family offices and corporates were now permitted to participate in eligible cash settled non-agricultural commodity derivatives contracts, as well as indices comprising of such cash settled non-agricultural commodities. Now, what does it mean in terms of FPI participation in MCX? Precious and base metals are all delivery-based contracts, so FPIs essentially will only be able to take positions in crude as well as natural gas-based derivatives, which are cash-settled contracts. Now, as far as energy contracts are concerned, in the first 9 months of this financial year, energy comprised of nearly 78% of the average daily turnover. In fact, MCX has a dominant market share in Indian energy futures at almost 99.52%. Overall, this development is positive for MCX, and that is because the move undertaken may lead to an increase in the FPI participation on its platform, and it also has the potential to boost volumes for the company, which in turn could translate to higher top line for MCX. So given that development, MCX on our radar.
Okay, all right. Thank you so much for joining us with that, Vamakshi. By the way, the Bank Nifty, that's recovering from the lows, and that is the reason why we are seeing that slight uptick in the Nifty as well. So just keep a track of that. But for now, we'll take your leave on this edition of Midcap Radar. Stay tuned. Your stocks will be returned.